Then he began to teach them that the Son of God must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. And after 3 days, rise. He said this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind on not of divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If anyone want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who will lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. This past week, I did something that I've done before, and from time to time, I do. I went through my closets. Yes, plural, closets. And I picked out some worn-out clothes, mildly worn some of them, but nonetheless, they were worn. Some of them I had cherished for quite some time, namely 3 seersucker suits and blazers. One of them was owned by a man down in the Delta. I found it when I'd gone through a bin in the storage room in the Family Life Center of the church after a rummage sale. This was left. It was a Southwick, gentlemen who know fashion. It was a Southwick blazer. There's no telling how old it was. Mr. Pond was a man of fashion, a man after my own heart. And I have worn that blazer for 15 years. With spring slacks and sometimes with jeans. So I took my bundle of clothes and I went to the thrift store on West Main. And on the way home, I felt sad. I thought, how hard is it to let go of some things that clutter your closet? Things that are worn out, they have sentimental value, but very little use anymore. And it reminded me of something I remembered from my childhood. I lived in the country for a while. And there's an expression used by country folk called spring cleaning. It's where folk took things out of their house that had been cooped up in a closet or in a ship row or in their house. They set them out in the front yard. And they let Mother Nature bring its fresh time spring into them. And then they decided if they wanted to keep them, would take them and put them back in maybe the same place or another place. Some of us know about that. It's easier said than done, though. I could justify keeping those seersucker suits and blazers. Some of them were given to me by some special friends. And I could justify keeping them. And I've also been in some other places that were cluttered. I don't know if you children have been with your grandparents to some communities around here, but I know that one person in our church took me to eat the world's greatest hamburger in his hometown. And there was a general store there, and there was a bunch of stuff in that store. It was cluttered. Now, I know they were valuable things to the owner, but if they'd have gotten a little clutter, you could have probably found some real good bargains in there. Clutter. Clutter has spiritual significance. It becomes apparent in the text that was just read when Jesus begins to talk about his future. Jesus and the disciples had stopped at Caesarea Philippi, a community on the Mediterranean Sea on the western coast of Palestine. And they stopped there, and Jesus stopped and asked them, the disciples, he said, what's the word on the street? What are you hearing about me? And you may recall that it was Simon Peter who believed Jesus to be the Messiah, and he declared that amidst his peers. Well, whatever Messiah meant to the disciples and to Peter that day, Jesus quickly shut it down. In fact, that's what verse 30 is about prior to our text. It was the same word he used to shut it down. It's the same word that he used to silence the demons that they'd encountered. You may recall over the past few weeks, Jesus has shown his ability and his authority over evil spirits of this world. It's that same word. And Jesus is about to unclutter the relationship he has with the disciples when he reveals to them, beginning in verse 31, about being and headed towards Jerusalem, where he would be perhaps arrested, beaten, tried, crucified, and in 3 days, resurrected. That news, when it hit the disciples, was most troubling, and most troubling of all it was to Peter, who got up and took Jesus aside, and he turned around and he said to him, would you shut up? This is crazy. And Jesus turned and used the same word. No, you shut up, Peter. Now, I said at 8:30 on purpose because there were little ones in the room. We don't use those words. But this is the reality of the text. This is the drama. This is the intensity of the moment. Dr. Otto Black, professor of theology from Princeton, says that this was a life or death moment for Jesus and the disciples. Jesus says to Peter, he identifies him as the adversary. You sound like the one I dealt with in the wilderness of my temptation. Satan, get behind me. Satan, the thief of the preached word. Satan, the tempter. Jesus said, you get behind me. Who do you think you are? To tell me, Peter had elevated himself to a place where he thought he could save Jesus. He uses the same word to silence Peter as he had the Satan himself. And so now with Jesus having Peter put behind him, he turns to the audience, the disciples who gathered and others as well, and perhaps to you and I with these next words. Jesus has revealed his purpose. He has rebuked Peter, and now he reveals the importance of renunciating self-centeredness. He contrasts this practice with a teaching about self-denial, which is the core of what it means to be a disciple. This means to choosing to side our lives with God rather than humankind. He calls them to pick up their cross. Now, folks, this would be no easy task and quite revolting to the first century folk because the cross was the electric chair of their day. The cross was a symbol of humiliation. It was a symbol of death. It was a symbol of execution and derision. And yet, as Jesus revealed these words to the disciples and to those who were gathered, his life's trajectory was headed towards Jerusalem. And the trajectory of Jesus' path was the cross. With all that has come his way, there seems no way for Jesus to be able to turn back. Clutter is a problem for Jesus, and he wants to make things clear for his followers. So he clears the clutter with this description of his future, and he takes it one step further in verse 34. He announces, if you are willing to lose your life for the sake of the gospel, you will be freed of the world's clutter. The key phrase in this text is "for the sake of the gospel." It is the heart of the moment. For Jesus is asking to clear out the clutter of what the world deems valuable. And for us and for his followers to trust the values of love and of self-giving and of surrender. He made a similar statement in an encounter he had with the Pharisees. They stopped him one day and they said, "Whose picture is on this coin?" They knew well and good whose picture was on the coin. It was a picture of Caesar. They said, "Should we render taxes under Caesar or who should we pay taxes to?" And Jesus paused. And you remember what he said. "Render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, but unto God the things that are God's." This was a problem for the disciples in this moment. Their minds are still cluttered on who Jesus is. Peter has just revealed to them publicly that Jesus is the long-awaited Messiah. Do you know what they wanted the Messiah to do? Do you know what the hopes and dreams of all of Israel's past sins and how she had gotten herself under the siege and power and dominion of Rome? Do you know what the Messiah was supposed to do? He was the second coming of David. The Messiah was supposed to run out the Romans and reestablish the power. Don't you wish, oh my goodness, we could go back to the good old days? Some of you have a favorite president. I'm sure I could guess a couple in the room. We could go back to the good old days. That's what they wanted. That's what they expected. They thought that Jesus was going to come and he was going to take them back to the good old days, the glory of Israel. This was cluttering the minds of the disciples. They could not see. They couldn't hear Jesus' invitation. Because if they did follow, they might end up like Jesus. Dead. And who wants to do that? Following Jesus, my friends, is not a lifestyle choice. It is a never-ending series of challenges, heartaches, joys, mysteries, and paradoxical adventures. At least that's what my 58 plus 59 years have been so far. If nothing else, these days of Lent provides us a time each year to go through our closets and consider things that are worn out and not useful for our journeys. I got to be honest with y'all. If you looked at my seersucker suits the other day, they were frayed around the lapels. And the colors, the blue and the tan colors, they had faded. And even if I would have gone down to Reed's or MLM's or Sears or whatever and bought a brand new tie and a kerchief and put it in, it would have looked good for a little while, but it wouldn't have lasted very long. They were worn out. They were really of no good use to me anymore. I can tell you that there are some thoughts and practices in my life that are just like those old suits. And you know what? It is hard to follow Jesus when your life is cluttered with stuff. Especially if that clutter is full of old ideas and set in stone beliefs and attitudes about who is a Christian and who is not and how much I can spend on me and my wants while others are dying of hunger and danger in our culture. How much time do I spend on my self-centered pursuits, ignoring moments that could enrich my life by paying attention and responding with my time and talent the way that Jesus has modeled it for me? It's hard to balance those complexities. I get it. I mean, we face a day where parents
have more on them than ever before. Some of our parents are raising their grandkids, and they're not as young as they used to be. And some of us are caring for our aging parents while we're dealing with our adult children and their kids. Some of them have left and we have had an empty nest, but now they've come back home and they brought more with them than when they left. That's not funny, really. How do we manage that? But when the trajectory of our lives is only upon ourselves, we lose. Even though our peers may perceive us when we don our seersucker coats or suits or skirts and look respectable and take our place in the world. Clutter gets in the way. Be it by material acquisition, social status, or even spiritual status, Reverend. And folks, I can't help but wonder what clutters our ministry at St. Luke. Old wounds are yet to be healed. I've experienced them. I've heard, I've seen, I've felt them over these past few months. A new building doesn't cure that, does it? We long for the good old days when Brother so-and-so was here. And we had lots of, and you can fill in the blank. Recent conflicts and murmurs. But before we dare point the finger, perhaps we need to take prayerful time in our own closet. What might we let go of to clear the clutter? What might God help us pick out to say, no, you don't need this anymore? It's doing more harm than good. You can't follow me if you hold on to this. Friends, Jesus' words have a claim on our life. And today it invites us into our closets of faith. Jesus can help us identify clutter. And he can help us let go of stuff that keeps us from following. As I was struggling this week with this message, a song, I'm sure you're surprised that a song came to me, but it did. It's a song from the Broadway musical that was popular in the 70s, and it's making a revival. In fact, Jesus Christ Superstar is making a revival. But this musical was Godspell. And in the musical about following Jesus, this beautiful song came to be popular. In fact, we sang it in my singing group in high school. Debbie Pickens from Vicksburg sang that song in our singing group. And here's part of the lyric. And I want to leave you with this lyric so that you might sing it this week. If you want to Google it, you can listen to it all week long. But here is what I'm about to share with you, to leave with you day by day. Day by day. Oh, dear Lord, three things I pray: to see thee more clearly, to love thee more dearly, to follow thee more nearly, day by day. God, through Jesus, can clear the clutter of our lives. God can help us make choices about things to save and
things to lose. God has made the way possible through Jesus for us. Day by day. Let us pray. Oh God, you know what's in our closets. And so do we. You know how hard it was this week to get this message together because of all the clutter in my life, because it was apparent, not just seersucker suits. There may be folk in this room right now who are really wrestling with things that are getting in the way. Loss and grief, secrets, addiction, struggling in school, learning how to be a teenager, finding hope in a world full of despair. But Lord, we know in our heart of hearts, we want to know you, to see you, to love you, and to follow you. But we try to do it our way. And we forget that you are the way. I confess that to you myself. So in this moment, in these moments ahead, help us to go through and take inventory of some things we need just to let go of. And maybe leave them here in this place today so you can take care of them. Because you know how to handle that. And that, Lord, just give us more grace to follow and to be faithful. Not perfect, but faithful. And may we find joy and peace and hope and love as we follow. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.